Let us stand and pray. If you take the order of service, we'll have the introductory prayers as mentioned on the first page of the order of service. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The waters of baptism, Christian died with Christ, may she now share eternal life with you. Lord, in our grief, we turn to you. O not the God of love, always ready to hear our cries. Listen to our prayers for your servant Christine, whom you have called out of this world. Lead her to your kingdom of light and peace, and count her among the saints in glory, through Christ our Lord. Amen. On the coffin, we place some symbols of her Christian life and love. First of all, the crucifix, a symbol of our Lord's death and resurrection. And of course, after her long battle with cancer, Christina have shared very much in the cross of Christ in recent years. Secondly, the book of the Gospels and church readings. She took to heart God's word, and I know from the family and from everybody else that she lived the practice of God's word too. May this word now be with her in eternity. Finally, bless her with holy water. Remind us again of baptism, the sacrament which begins our Christian lives altogether. I'd like to welcome all to this Mass today for Christine, especially obviously Brian and the four children, Tom, Jim, Mary and Peter, and their families and friends, also the extended family of Christine's siblings, whom I knew well from my War's End days, and who are all with us still together today. And many friends of hers from Sacred Heart Grammar School and from the War's End area too, who shared her life and love all down the years. Let us pray. Listen kindly to our prayers, O Lord, as our faith in your Son, raised from the dead, is deepened. May our hope of resurrection also for your departed servant, Christine, find new strength through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, living in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Could we sit up and reading now, please, which, as you know, is from the prophet Isaiah.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord will destroy death forever. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will prepare for all peoples a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he will remove the mourning veil covering all peoples and the shroud enwrapping all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He will take away his people's shame everywhere on earth. For the Lord has said so. That day it will be said, "See, this is our God, in whom we hoped for salvation. The Lord is the one in whom we hoped. We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us." The word of the Lord. The response in the responsorial psalm is, "The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want." The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me repose. Near restful waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit. He guides me along the right path. He is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me comfort. You have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil. My cup is overflowing. Surely goodness and kindness shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that bears no fruit, he cuts away. Every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes to make it bear even more. You are pruned already by means of the word I have spoken to you.
Make your home in me as I make mine in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit all by itself, but must remain part of the vine, neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Whoever remains in me, with me in him, bears fruit in plenty, for cut off from me you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is like a branch that has been thrown away. He withers. These branches are collected and thrown on the fire, and they are burnt. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, you may ask what you will, and you shall get it. It is to the glory of my Father that you should bear much fruit, and then you will be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments, remain in his love. I have told you this, so that my own joy may be in you, and your joy be complete. The Gospel of the Lord. This homily I'm about to deliver was run through Brian, and he chopped some bits out and put other extra bits in. So his census pen is very heavily involved in this little homily I'm giving now. So blame him as well as me for this. It's been my privilege to say this Mass and to prepare this, actually, because obviously, as a distant member of the family, I'm deeply involved in what went on. To many of us who have endured wet weather for months, the first reading may sound very odd. However, the Old Testament Jewish people lived in a hot, dry country with frequent droughts and famines. Their dream was of a damp mountain top with plenty of water, cool breezes, and rich pasture for animals. In other words, where living was comfortable. Of course, the Church sees this dream as an image of life after death, not in any literal or physical sense, but as a symbolic of a state where there will be security, with no danger and no more suffering. Christians shared that hope, and this homily shall try to show why this was the case. She was born on the 9th of December 1951 to a family that was part of the strong Catholic community of Old Wall's End. Her father, Wilfred Thompson, Wilfie, and my father, Jimmy Dunn, were cousins. I always refer to her parents as Uncle Wilf and Auntie Mary. For people of their generation and ours, the practice of the Catholic faith was a normal part of daily life. Sadly, for many reasons, that close-knit world of St. Columba's Parish in Wall's End Town Centre, and where I grew up, St. Aidan's in Willington Quay, have gone. Christine was the middle child in a family of five. Teresa and Michael were older, Claire and Peter were younger. She went to St. Columba's Schools, and after 11 plus, to the Sacred Heart Girls' Grammar School in Newcastle. There she made friends, many friends for life, welcome some of them today in the middle bench there. After school in 1971, she went to Lancaster University to study English. And following her graduation, she moved down to the south, getting a job with the Camden Council, working to improve children's literacy. While she loved the job and the children, she could not get used to living in London, so she jumped at the chance to return to the northeast. The North Tyneside Council had advertised a job at the newly established Buddle Arts Centre in Wall's End, involving the organisation of supplies for children's libraries. She got the post and was really happy in this combination of library work and helping children. Loves how she met her husband, Brian. They met professionally at a conference on children's literature at the Pendowans Teacher Centre in Newcastle. Obviously, they just clicked and started going out together. This led to true love. They married in St. Columba's Church in 1979. They were to have four children, Tom, James, Mary, and Peter. After living for a while at Benton, the family moved up to Wyden Burn, just up the hill from Hexham Town Centre, near here. Now this is where Brian says what I have to say. Brian was a lot, and even he will admit, even boast about this, older than Christine. When the opportunity came, he gleefully took early retirement from his post at Newcastle Polytechnic, later called Northumberland University. This allowed him to be much more involved in the bringing up of the children. Christine, meanwhile, moved into teaching in the private sector, where she worked in special needs, particularly helping children with dyslexia. Like all mums, she was glad to see her children grow up and branch out for themselves. She was delighted when they found partners, married and had their own families. She loved her grandchildren as they came along. Wilfred, Edward, Robbie, Rosie, Freddie, Imogen, Kit and Martha. To my shame, I did not visit her enough, but when I did, I was amazed by how positive she sounded, despite the severity of her illness. I suggest that the reason for this was her faith. I mentioned at the start that she was filled with hope, and I think that her strong faith was the cause of that hope. The gospel chosen for this Mass is one of the most comforting in the New Testament, the very rural idea of Jesus being a sort of vine stock, and we, his followers, being like the branches that spring from it and depend on it. The point is that the branches are of no use unless they are attached to the vine. Jesus means that our faith must be attached to him, as it was in Christine's case, by sharing our Jesus' life in personal prayer and our church's sacraments. But this idea of the vine does not mean that there are no problems for those who believe in Christ. It talks about our being pruned, and this means facing difficulties in life and painfully learning from them. Some of these are the result of the challenge of Jesus' moral code. His word means that we can't behave as many others do, and this can cause both inconvenience and sometimes embarrassment. Other difficulties are the result of human suffering, especially serious illness. I know that many people lose their faith when faced with suffering, either their own or that of people whom they love. A major feature of our Christian faith is that Jesus himself suffered in the way we do, and for many of us, that gives us hope and confidence in what he said. I cannot justify or explain away human suffering, but all I can say is that the Son of God went through it too and was raised to new life. Christine believed this. Along with faith in Christ's promises, she also followed his rule that we should love one another. Jesus loved his Father, and he wants us to find the same happiness and fulfillment that he had as God's Son. This, along with his promise of eternal life, is no mere pipe dream. It's based on what the apostles heard and saw Jesus say and do. They shared his experiences, and as members of their church, so do you and I. Christine believed and shared her love with her family, her friends, and those less fortunate than herself. Her death naturally makes us all sad, but that sadness is balanced by the fact that her sufferings are now over, that she has found an eternal home with the Lord. She left us a legacy of love in Brian, her own children and grandchildren, her extended family, the many friends she has made down the years. A marvelous woman. May she rest in peace. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May she rest in peace. Amen. May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, for the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Can we stand up now, please, for the bidding prayers, the prayer of the faithful? God the Almighty Father, raised Christ his Son from the dead. With confidence, we ask him to save all this people, the living and the dead.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness. Lord, in your mercy. For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face. Lord, in your mercy. For our family and friends, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. Lord, in your mercy. For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pause for a moment in silence to present all our prayers to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Let us ask Mary to join us in prayer as we say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
God, creator and redeemer of all the faithful, grant to the soul of your servant departed, Christine, release from all her sins. Hear our prayers for those we love, and give them the pardon they have always desired. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We sit down again now, please, to the offertory prayers, which I'll do. And the music now is played from Bach, the chorale prelude. Could we stand up, please? Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, that departed servant Christine may be taken up into the glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, if you're faithful, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, eternal dwellings made ready for us in heaven. And so with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and all the hosts and powers of heaven, sing the hymn of your glory, as without end, we now acclaim, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Can we kneel or sit now for the central part of our Mass, the Eucharistic prayer, where we commemorate our Lord's Last Supper. This is prayer number 3, if you wish to follow it. Prayer number 3. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that, from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Saviour of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Stephen, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. Your compassionate and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Christine, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, united with this son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. And from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body and the pattern of his own glorious body. To our other departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, and we'll wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us now stand, and we'll turn to God our Father in the very words our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's rejoice in the sign of that peace together. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word. For a blessing. If it's for a blessing, which may be appropriate for you today, just come forward to me personally with the hands crossed like that and the head bowed for our blessing on this very special day for our parish and for our group of families here.
Thank you.
the sacrament of his body and blood. Mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Christine may come to the eternal table of Christ in heaven, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. We now come to the final commendation of Christine's body before we take it away, and we now have our prayers of parting. Trusting in God, we pray together for Christine. Now we come to a last farewell. There is sadness in the parting, but we trust in the hope that one day we shall see her again and enjoy her friendship. Though this congregation may disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console each other in the faith of Jesus Christ. And now let's blow with water again, and then we incense it as a symbol of offering to God the love and happiness that Christine brought many people, her marriage, her family, her work, her friendships here and in the past. All of this we rolled up together and offered to God in thanksgiving with these little gestures of water and incense. The commendation prayer. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Christine, in the assured and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she rise with him one day on the last day. We give thanks for the blessing bestowed upon her in this life, her marriage, her family, her friendships. Your thanks to a sign of your goodness and a fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. Help us remain after her, to comfort each other with assurances of faith, as we will meet in Christ, with our sister forever, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you, take the Holy City, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May cries of angels welcome you, and lead you to the bosom of Abraham, where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. Let's now take Christ into a place of rest. Now thank you on behalf of the thankful who are coming to here today. And we're going to the cemetery for a small private ceremony of burial. And then please do go through the hall afterwards for refreshments, into the hall next door there, for refreshments, and we will catch up with you later on. Can we stand for our final hymn now, please? The recessional hymn, I the Lord of Sea and Sky.